So thank you, Jean, for those two kind words. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming to celebrate books, and particularly all our new books, but particularly these two books on Raphael's images. Now, can everybody hear me? So the topic is Raphael, which is a deep and vast topic, a mystery, in fact, which I can only start to introduce tonight with a few scattershot thoughts and images. And the books, which I shall describe briefly later, following Jean, will have to do the rest. To begin, or by way of beginning, for me it's almost magically appropriate that we are gathered here in the midst of Advent. The verses around, the children's verses really say what I am now going to say. And darkness increases and the deep silence of midwinter approaches and we anticipate the coming of the light. Withdrawn into herself, the earth rests self-contained in her spiritual nature. All her forces and processes are drawn into herself. Now, in his lecture on the Christmas imagination, Rudolf Steiner describes this state of the earth at midwinter by saying that the earth is pregnant. And then he tells of an old saying that every child is a child of the sun, and how everyone, every woman who bears a child is like the earth in midwinter. And then he points to the Sistine Madonna and says that it was born out of the great instinctive knowledge of nature that prevailed in ancient times. For, he said, it's a picture of the imagination which must in fact come to anyone who translates his or her inner vision of the secrets of Christmas in such a way that those secrets become a living experience and reality. Now, this is certainly an enigmatic saying, but one which, linking the Madonna to the earth, the mother of all life linking her to the earth, suggests something of the Madonna's deep primordial universality, the mother of all life, coeval with the earth's evolution, and also at the same time of the significance of the Advent mood to understand the Madonna, the mood of open, patient, peaceful, patient waiting, poised between past and future, memory and hope, birth and new birth, old time and new time. In historical time, we may say, Mary awaits the coming of her child in Bethlehem. But in another time, she is giving birth perpetually. And in still another time, we are all children of Mary. For Mary is the mother of us all, as Jesus proclaimed from the cross when he spoke to John, the beloved disciple, and said, "Behold your mother." At the same time, however, we are each one of us our own mother, as Eckhart reminds us when he says, "I must be Mary and give birth to Christ." Or as Angelus Silesius, much loved by Rudolf Steiner, put it, "Christ could be born 1,000 times in Bethlehem, but it's all in vain unless he's born in you." So that's a little introduction. So to the new books, the one book is a book of images for reflection, contemplation, and meditation. To be seen, these books ask only to be approached with an open heart and an open mind, without any preconception or judgment, and with a certain vulnerability or willingness to be seen. Approached in this way, the images will speak for themselves according to one's need. The second book, Healing Madonnas, is much more complex. It seeks to provide an initial foundation or groundwork or set of questions for the sequence of 15 images of the Madonna, created sometime between 1908 and 1911 by the anthroposophical doctor Felix Pipers. Now, with the consent or guidance or collaboration of Rudolf Steiner, we don't know. And they were created initially for therapeutic use under the supervision of Dr. Pfeiffer's for soul wounds, those suffering from soul wounds, and this was to take place in his psychiatric clinic. However, they are just as, and perhaps even more accessible, simply for meditation and contemplation and one's own transformation by following them through. Now, the sequence is made up of 12 works of art, which will be unfolding as I speak. 10 by Raphael, with a relief by Donatello, and a sculpture by Michelangelo. 4 works are thus repeated, namely the Sistine Madonna and the Transfiguration. Because the first part of the sequence, the first 8 images, begins and ends with the Sistine Madonna, now past. And the Sistine Madonna thus contextualizes or frames one's mood of these first 8 images. The second half, namely the 7 final images, is framed by 2 details from Raphael's Transfiguration, opening with the head of the transfigured Christ and closing with his full figure, leaving not dealing at all with the whole bottom half of the painting. So we could say that the Sistine Madonna establishes the fundamental mood of reverence or devotion or openness, as Rudolf Steiner speaks of in the opening chapter of How to Know Higher Worlds, while the Transfiguration transforms this reverence into a kind of inner certitude, security, or faith, such that life, you lift me up, you carry me forward no matter what, but it's without an object, a faith without an object, just this sense of certainty. Now, the sequence isn't random. You need to know this. It has a purpose. It's meant, when contemplated sequentially, to purify and harmonize the etheric or life body of the contemplator. And it does this by following the form of a pentagram, as this is inscribed, as you move from picture to picture, by the progressive movement of the child Jesus' placement in relation to his mother. In other words, after the initial Sistine Madonna, as one image follows another, the placement of Jesus in relation to the Madonna describes a pentagram. And in so doing, it accompanies the etheric currents, harmonizing the etheric currents as these flow through the human body, the body of the human being. Now, there is much, much more about this in the book, but I just let you know that is what lies behind the sequence. And should say also that very little is actually known about this sequence. Few accounts of the use of the sequence are known. They're in the book. The most likely story is that it came as the idea came to Felix Pipers. And it did so during a lecture on the Egyptian mysteries, in which Rudolf Steiner spoke of the ancient healing mysteries of Isis and intimately connected Isis with the Mary of the Sistine Madonna, drawing parallels between them, as if the one was the evolutionary metamorphosis of the other. And in fact, we know that our images of Mary are based on the images, Egyptian images of Isis and Horus in the very early times. Rudolf Steiner, as I said, never spoke about it. But no matter what the origin, it's a strange thing. The sequence bears very deep marks of Rudolf Steiner's whole vision and teaching. And if one really explores it, both through practice and thinking about it, one finds oneself ramifying into the deepest roots of anthroposophy. That is to say, just to open up the door a little, it is at once a contemporary creation and an evolutionary metamorphosis of ancient spiritual experience, the mysteries of Isis. And so, from this point of view, it provides us with a beautiful example of what Rudolf Steiner called the new mysteries. The mysteries brought about through the mystery of Golgotha, at a time when the ancient mysteries, which were oriented toward the primeval past, they looked back to the beginning, were falling into decay and losing their power. And you all know that in response to this, the divine spiritual world turned wholly to the earth with a supreme sacrificial gift and deed of love, namely the becoming all flesh of the Word, the divine Logos, and its uniting for all time with the earth and humanity. And out of this arose the new mysteries, mysteries of love, oriented not toward the past, the beginning, but toward the future, creative of it, toward the end. The new mysteries are apocalyptic in their very basis. They're working towards the end, they're looking forward, they're creative of the future. Love is always of the not yet. When you love, it's always not yet. Your love is creative. And like the ancient mysteries, these new mysteries also always reflect the unity of divinity, cosmos, humanity, and the earth. But rather than descending from the past in a dreamlike manner, in a dreamlike manner to priest initiates, these new mysteries are oriented, as I said, to the future as love, and they come about consciously through the intentional work of selfless human experience, light-filled and available to every human being. Nor should we forget, thinking about this, that to love is to heal. The mysteries of love are the mysteries of healing, the mysteries of healing. Remember how Jesus, who was called the universal medicine, healed the sick, and how he sent out the disciples to preach the kingdom of God and heal the sick. He sent them out in twos, two by two, that is, in relationship. And they did this, traveling through the towns, preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. Now, this tradition was carried by the healing monks and nuns throughout the Middle Ages, and it's still with us today. The injunction is still to bear one another's burdens and to wash one another's feet. In a word, as the first rule of the Rosicrucian Brotherhood stated, which Rudolf Steiner knew well and practiced, those on the path are enjoined to have no profession but to heal, and that gratis, namely as gift. It's thus more than appropriate that Raphael, our painter, bears the name of the Archangel of Healing. Born on Good Friday, 1483, and dying on Good Friday, 1520, Raphael, we might say, was the bearer of the future force of the highest healing ideals of Renaissance universalism. Ideals that would find their true response first among those poets and philosophers at the turn of the 19th century, Goethe above all, Novalis, Fichte, Hegel, Schelling, and others, Rudolf Steiner's teachers, whose work was a reflection of the Michael School. The Michael School was meeting in the heaven at the time the Romanticism took place on earth. So it's a sort of foreshadowing of the Michael School. And naturally, this movement, this recognition of Raphael, which was set in motion by these Romantic philosophers and poets, finds its fulfillment in anthroposophy. Now, Raphael was worldly in many ways, and he was also familiar, we must say, with all the esoteric currents and spiritual currents of his age. He was aware and knew of and talked to, had friends among the Marsilio Ficino's Platonic Academy. He knew Pico della Mirandola and the Christian Kabbalist and Cardinal Viterbo de Egidio, and he was very familiar with Kabbalistic doctrines, so that he understood that from a certain point of view, and that the Madonna is the Shekinah, the divine presence, as well as the glory of God. At the same time, he had a foot in the Middle Ages and was very aware of all the different theories of vision, physical, imaginal, spiritual, and so that he was well prepared, in fact, to be this fundamentally prophetic and transformational figure. Now, who was he? Esoterically, for Rudolf Steiner, he was more than just a painter, as Jean pointed out. He was one of humanity's great guides and teachers. He was one of those beings whose presence, by whose presence human evolution is guided and enriched. And for Steiner, the reality of this, the central importance of Raphael emerged only gradually as he began to focus his spiritual research around 1910, not so much on the paintings. He had spoken much about the paintings and Isis and Madonna, but now he began to focus on the individuality of Raphael, who lay behind them. And as he did so, as this research intensified, he came to understand that Raphael's mission had to be understood, as Jean said, in the light of the progressive incarnations of a single, evolving, complex, world historical figure. In the long haul, there are lots of figures associated with this individuality, but in the beginning it was Elijah, John the Baptist, Raphael, and then Novalis. And it's amazing to think of Novalis, who we'll hear about, in front of the Sistine Madonna, which in a previous incarnation he painted. And all sorts of very funny things like that. Now, for Rudolf Steiner, this was, as Jean pointed out, a continuous revelation. As a theme of research on this prophetic line, this continuously changing line, he continued almost until his death. And in fact, the very last lecture he ever gave returned to this theme and added, as Jean said, to the incarnational sequence, the beloved disciple Lazarus, John. And talking with Ludwig Knoll, a doctor and friend, he described this event as follows. He says, at the raising or awakening of Lazarus, the spiritual being of John the Baptist, who since his death had been overshadowing the disciples, penetrated from above into Lazarus himself, as far as his consciousness soul, and the being of Lazarus from below intermingled with the spiritual being of John the Baptist from above, and after the awakening, the being became Lazarus John, the disciple whom Jesus loved. He loved him as Lazarus. Jesus loved Lazarus. Now, in this last lecture, he incorporates this detail into it, but it's an amazing piece in this last lecture because he gives us a poetic sort of contemplation. He leads the audience and leads the reader through a meditation going through Raphael's experiences after death as he passes through the spheres. And this gives you some idea of the complexity and of this vision. Contemplate Raphael, he says, how he passes through the gate of death, taking with him the power of his art, which already shone on earth with the bright light of the stars. See how he enters the moon sphere, meeting with the spirits who live in there, who are spiritual individualities of the original great leaders of humanity, with whose wisdom, as Elijah, he had been deeply inspired. He meets these beings, and he meets too with all the souls that he has lived with in earlier stages of earth evolution. We see how he unites himself spiritually with the spiritual origin of the earth. We see him completely at home, united with those whom he had most loved to be with in the Elijah existence, because it was they who at the beginning of earth existence set the goals for life on this earth. We see him wander through the Mercury sphere, where together with the great cosmic healers, he transforms his spiritual being, for his spiritual being, the power that had been his to create what is so infinitely whole and healthy in color and line. All that he has painted, whether on canvas or as a fresco, for the help and comfort, as well as for the unending inspiration for such as can understand his work, all his work, radiant with light, showed itself to him now and in the great cosmic connection with which it was able to stand as it passed through the healing beings of Mercury. Then he who on earth had unfolded so great a love for art, whose soul had been aflame with love for color and line, was transplanted into the sphere of Venus, which bore him across to the sun, to sun existence, which lived in all his incarnations, so far as they are yet known to us. For it was from the sun that he, as the prophet Elijah, brought to humankind through the medium of his own people the truths that belong to the goals of existence. We see how in the sun sphere he is also able once more to live through in a deep and intimate sense what he underwent when through the initiation of Christ, he, Lazarus, became John. The truth is, my dear friends, said Rudolf Steiner, this earthly personality of Raphael was completely yielded up and was present only through what Lazarus John gave to this soul to be poured out into color and line for all humanity. Now, so this is an important guy. Now, what lies behind this? What is something else in this? And that is what Rudolf Steiner calls the mystery known to the Rosicrucians. Now, according to this mystery, which he speaks about in the temple legend, in the early lectures in the 1907, after the expulsion from paradise, in the beginning, after the expulsion from paradise, Abel was born of Adam and Eve, but Cain, his brother, but actually his elder half-brother, was born of Eve not by Adam, but by one of the Elohim. This is a legend, it's a metaphor. This is to say that Cain was in a certain sense divine human, whereas Abel was purely human. Abel, the keeper of sheep, if you remember from Genesis, accepts and serves life as it is given to him. He's a herder. In sacrifice, and called to sacrifice, he offers one of his lambs. While Cain, the tiller of the earth, offers something that he has himself produced, the product of his own hard labor and ingenuity, agriculture in this case. That is to say, says Rudolf Steiner, there are these two approaches to the spirit. One he calls the Cain stream, the other the Abel stream, but we can just think of them as two approaches. Those belonging to the Cain stream recognize that they contain a God within. And this God within calls them to become creators, transformers of the earth, workers in the arts and sciences. They become scientists, architects, city planners, painters, poets. But those on the Abel stream, on the other hand, feel that divinity is to be received from above, and in that sense they're surrendered to grace in a way. So theirs in a way is the path of the heart, the path of what Rudolf Steiner calls heart clairvoyance. The path depends on accepting life humbly and without resistance, just as it is. Everything you just accept it. Life, you lift me up and you carry me forward. Able stream, in that sense, stresses other power in more Buddhist terms, while the Cane tradition stresses own power. And the Cane stream really stands there as a second creator working in and on the world. And this distinction actually is similar to others. You can think of in Hindu, you've got the Brahmins and the Kshatriyas, the warriors, the priests and the warriors. You have the royal and the sacerdotal path. You have the continuous conflict in medieval history between the Pope and the Holy Roman Emperor. That's the Cain side and the Abel side. But Rudolf Steiner put anthroposophy unquestionably into the Cain stream. And in the Cain stream, too, are Elijah, John the Baptist, Lazarus, John, Raphael, Novalis, not to mention many others. Now, each of these brings something transformative into creation. In other words, just as Elijah proclaimed in Steiner's words, that which humanity may call the divine is accessible only in the innermost center of one's being, one's I, for his time. And then John the Baptist proclaims, transform your souls, repent, metanoia, repent, for the kingdom is heaven is nigh. So Raphael, in Rudolf Steiner's words, proclaimed through his paintings, quotes, a form of Christianity independent of all differences of doctrine, thus making Christianity itself universal beyond sectarian and even religious differences. It is universal. Christianity began as a religion, but it's greater than a religion. Of this, Raphael is the prophet. In this sense, Raphael was reintroduced the true idea of the secular. So I would propose that actually there's a lot of questions about, are these images religious? Are they, Christian? No. But I would propose that they are spiritual secular. They belong to everybody, because in the original sense, secular did not mean atheist, humanist, materialist. Secular in the Middle Ages meant the age, the present world, the seculum, the immanent, sensory, present, actual world we live in contrast to the future or the world to come, the divine, spiritual, eternal realm. The secular was never opposed to the profane, nor was it ever actually separate from the kailum or heaven. Because the sphere of the seculum, this world, that is, this world that is wisdom, that is to become love, that will become a sun, is actually spiritual right down into its matter, no less than the kailum or heaven. It's just this world. Now, so that's a sort of more esoteric view of Raphael. Now, if we look at Raphael exoterically and consider the paintings, we are confirmed in this esoteric view. For it's generally accepted that Raphael's paintings, besides being exquisitely beautiful works of art, mark a significant turn in the evolution of consciousness, what might be called the shift from religion to spirituality. This is because, although in the beginning, at his own time, Raphael painted primarily in response to religious commissions. These were mostly altarpieces. How he painted them, when we get to the 18th century, goes beyond religion. If Christianity began as a religion but is greater than a religion, Raphael's paintings may have begun as religious paintings, but they are much, much more than religious paintings now. So they are not, neither icons, which employ a reverse perspective, what's called a reverse perspective, in which the viewer stands at the vanishing point, and it and the icon functions as a window opening into the infinite depths of the divine, nor are they portraits in which a model is portrayed as the Madonna. Raphael's paintings are best described as visionary. They are visions. And using one-point perspective, the single-point perspective, which was rediscovered in the Renaissance, against itself, because usually this perspective, which is can be related to Cartesianism and the subject-object and the human against the world, to seal off the spiritual, to reify the world and seal off the spiritual. But what Raphael discovered was that this same perspective could be used to open to the realm of the visionary, permitting the vision or imagination to become a direct experience, one that allows the supernatural, the suprasensory events to enter into the viewer's own natural visual space, and so allows the contemplator, the viewer, to actualize internally in themselves this supernatural, suprasensory nature. And so from this point of view, Raphael was one of the great innovators of visionary painting. Over his short life, he was able to accomplish the depiction and communication in and through painting of a visionary inner experience that the beholder of the painting could experience inwardly in their own way for themselves. He made it possible for the beholder to appropriate the painting's vision in a deeply experiential way, but to see it as they were able to see it. And this was available to anyone who could bring to it the appropriate quality of devotion. Now, we don't have it up there, but in your mind's eye, consider the Sistine Madonna. This clearly offers itself as a vision. Presents a kind of window or stage across the bottom, a parapet, if you remember. In the center, two angels, two putti, as if just arrived, support themselves on their arms, their gaze turned soulfully up to the Madonna. A curtain rod hangs across the top of the painting. Curtains, as if just drawn aside, hang from it, and they frame this scene theatrically, almost architecturally. The saints, Sixtus, Saint Sixtus, after whom the Sistine Madonna is named, Sixtus and Barbara, stand on either side of the Madonna. Sixtus on the left, gestures that we should behold what he sees. On the right, Barbara is withdrawn. Her eyes look down in a chaste gesture of humility and beatitude. Between them stands the Virgin holding up the child. Ethereal cherubs' heads surround her in perpetual movement and adoration. Balanced between walking and standing, she stands firmly but lightly on the clouds as if on solid ground, and she holds the child up like Isis, almost as if on a throne, and the child's gaze is penetrating, fixed on the viewer. He seems illuminated from above, and he illuminates all around him. Mother is serious, focused, inward. Both are surrounded by light. But where is the image? Is the image that the curtain could conceal or reveal? What you are seeing is purely a vision. Now, this is not me. This is a wonderful art historian called Hans Belting says, we see neither a picture plane that coincides with the panel, nor a picture space that opens behind the frame and the curtain. Surface and space recede in a cloud of light, a cloud bank that usually also bears the two saints. The curtain is the only remaining residue of the material image. Its physical presence is shared only by what was previously was the threshold of the picture at the bottom, where the two putti are. The curtain and the parapet at the bottom remain close to the eye as if one could touch them. They're very close. While beyond them opens this immeasurable distance, a non-space without boundaries. The cloud bank, which dissolves in the distance into cloudy angels, reinforces the impression of a celestial vision. There, however, it is. There it's a motive in the background. Indeed, it rises above the horizon of a landscape that includes the donor and the saints. Earlier paintings may contain a heavenly vision, but the Sistine Madonna is one. The work appeals to the inner vision rather than creating the window illusion that it has to be taken at face value. In the absence of natural space, the figures without spatial coordinates appear as if directly before our eyes. Only the two putti have a measurable place in the picture. The presence of the main figures is set free, etc., etc. The visible work makes visible an invisible reality. And so what's revealed by the Sistine Madonna is an act of the artist's vision or imagination, his fantasia, they called it in Italian. And it's addressed to the viewer to make that vision his or her own. That is to say, the painting is a new creation that each viewer or contemplator or meditator likewise creates in his or her own soul. So and Novalis, standing in front of the Sistine Madonna in 1776, got this immediately and wrote, "Mary, in a thousand images, adorably I see you shown, but none of these can show you as my soul beholds you." How are we doing for time?
Keep going.
Okay, I'm about half, over half. Take a break now, because this is actually then, when we're talking about working with the Madonna images, either contemplatively or therapeutically, we're talking about ways of seeing. How can we see in this, inside-outside way? How can we begin to know what we see rather than see what we know? How can we learn to see beyond what is already known, what we think we already know, beyond the already constructed, objectified world of projected representations and concepts, beyond subject and object dualism? That is to say, can we begin to understand that seeing can become a spiritual practice? That is to say, just as one kind of practice, you could say, tries to rise from dead thinking and dead thoughts to living thinking and living thoughts. Another practice then could equally seek to transform dead seeing into living seeing, dead images into living images. Just so too, a practice of speech could work to transform dead words into living words, to living speech. Now, overcoming this, the literality of the seen object, its objectness, such living seeing, in the process of such living seeing, seeing becomes an I-thou kind of encounter with a being or another being. Now, I've had the experience, many people probably have the experience of walking through a museum. Rilke had it powerfully when he wrote his poem, The Archaic Torso of Apollo, if anybody knows that poem. But anyway, you walk through a museum, you glance at the works, you hardly pause, you sort of you know, stick labels on them as you go past, when suddenly, at one particular work, you stop. And almost involuntarily, you're drawn to sit down in front of it. Your attention is, at that point, unfocused. It's focused, I mean, but it's sort of unknowing. And it's drawn toward the image. And any expectation you might have had of what was going to happen drops away. And you begin to experience what it means to surrender oneself to what you are seeing. For a moment, perhaps a long moment, seeing is then no longer located in you. It's out of the body. It's located in the world. It fills the world. And one realizes that one sees that we are seen, that something sees us before we see. We are seen before we see. In the same way as St. John will say of love, he loved us first. That's why we can love. We are seen. That's why we can see. And that the seeing occurs between these two gazes. Gazes meet, and in the communion of the encounter, one's soul enters into the image, and the image enters one's soul. Seeing then becomes not a thing, but an event, an experience. Not a what, but a how. A process, not a sight, but a way of seeing. Not a fixed meaning, a fixed anything, but a pattern, a rhythm, a metamorphosing series of relationships opening infinitely into an ocean of a world forever unfolding meaning. Rudolf Steiner said somewhere, and I can never find this quote again, that one never sees an angel, if anybody knows where he says that, but one has the experience of being seen by an angel. One feels the gaze of an angel caressing you. It falls upon you. Now, in true seeing, in my experience, you enter, it's the same thing. You enter a state that Emily Dickinson called the place where presence is, the circumference between. Judgment is laid aside. In sort of a complete inner quietude, seeing and being seen, entering into and being entered into, one experiences the other's experience. So you experience the vision, as Vale said, more in yourself. Now, you can't will this state, obviously. But if you just gently, humbly, naturally, you know, try it. A gentle process, natural process of letting go of thoughts, of not willing, of willing not to will, it can be cultivated. And then it will rise or ascend, descend of its own accord. And then you will be able to have the vision. It will be yours in a way that you unite in imagination vision with the other, or, and this could be a person, a landscape, a painting. And in this matter itself, an image becomes transparent, a conduit of transformative, wisdom-filled healing forces. That's why it's healing, because of this what can happen. It's not just that the child goes in the pentagon, but if the person in front of it is open in this way, there's a mystical marriage, you might say, can occur between what is the seer seeing and the seen. In Rudolf Steiner's words, we must learn to permit things to speak to us. We must grow ever more passive toward things and permit them to express their secrets in their own way. Doing so, their vision arises in us. So I'll leave seeing there, there's much more in the book, and turn to this other question of the religious or spiritual secular. Because this is a question that I know a lot of Waldorf teachers often get asked, is this a religious school? Why do you have this religious thing on the wall? Are you a Christian school? What is it? Whether despite being beyond doctrinal differences, these Madonna images are still religious, or are they in some perhaps yet to be discovered way spiritual secular? Or are they both religious and spiritual secular? And it is up to each one of us to decide. It's always up to each one of us to decide. One can decide only for oneself. It's not a new question. And actually it happened when the Sistine Madonna came into the public view. And at that time, many works like Raphael's were beginning to be removed from their sacred contexts in convents, churches, monasteries, and began to be displayed. Europe began to have museums, first the Louvre in Paris from Napoleon, and very closely afterwards, the museum in Dresden. The Louvre came later. Dresden came first, I think. And so there's real question. These objects of worship or devotion became visible suddenly as paintings, sculptures, reliefs. In other words, they became visible for the first time as works of art, as the fruit of individual artistic creativity and vision, as technical skill and genius, and thus raising the question of what's the meaning of art? And what's the meaning of the museum? Is the museum to be pedagogic? Was its mission to display through works of art the evolving nature of humanity and consciousness? Or was the mission of a museum to be a temple of art, a new kind of temple, a place where human art, where art, human creation, human poiesis, making, was to be celebrated as sacred and holy in itself? And did this then mean that the artists were the new priests? That everybody should become an artist, a priest? And this was certainly the Romantics' view. Novalis, for instance, hoped as much when he said poet and priest were one in the beginning. Only later times have separated them. The true poet, however, is always a priest, just as the true priest has always remained a poet. Ought not the future to bring back this ancient condition? And radical though this sounded at the time, others following Goethe, whose belief it was that each person should have their own religion, that religion was an individual or personal, not collective, question, added that not just poets, but all artists, each one of us, should become priests or artists of our own religion. In other words, everyone an artist, as Joseph Beuys proclaimed in his rather radical interpretation of the philosophy of freedom. And so this happened with the Sistine Madonna. It suddenly, for 200 years, it had gathered dust in the convent in Piacenza, for which Raphael had painted it. And then in 1754, Augustus, Elector of Saxony, whose father was already a great collector, and this was the time of the great collectors, these wealthy people were just buying up everything, purchased the Sistine Madonna. It was the only Madonna in Germany at the time. When it arrived, he said, make way for the great Raphael. And he put it in his museum. He put it in. He made it like an altar. That then fired German imagination for the next 150 years. During philosophical and artistic imagination, that is through the time of Rudolf Steiner, right up to, for instance, mid-century, when Martin Heidegger, the famous philosopher, could still, in a short essay, say, all unanswered questions about art and artwork cluster around this painting. Now, it all began with Winckelmann. I don't know, Winckelmann was the great German apostle of art. He wrote a book called Reflections on the Imitation of Greek Works. And at the very moment the painting was arrived and displayed, he was about to go to Rome to complete this book. However, he just had time to pop in and see it. And what he wrote in the Reflections is, "Behold this Madonna, her face filled with innocence and extraordinary greatness in a posture of blissful serenity. It is the same serenity with which the ancients imbued the depictions of their deities." Had Winckelmann not got in there and managed to put that in his book before he left, the question might never have been asked of Raphael's Madonna whether it looked like a goddess of antiquity. I mean, so that they have all the Greek sculptures of Athena and Persephone and Aphrodite, and now they, and what's the difference? Is this the same being as Isis was the same being? Was she a goddess like a goddess of antiquity, or was she a Christian goddess, or a saint, or something wholly new, expressing something ancient and modern, at once Christian and universal, deeply ancient and of the future, divine and at the same time profoundly human? And then following Winckelmann, the whole thing was complicated by a young man called Wackenroder, who's a friend of Kleist and Novalis and all of them. And at the age of 22, he wrote a book called The Confessions of an Art-Loving Friar. And this came out a year after Winckelmann. And in this novel, he creates the legend of Raphael's vision, Raphael's dream. He tells of how this art-loving friar, searching through old manuscripts in his monastery, found several sheets of paper, manuscript, and one of which tells about Raphael. He's writing a letter to his friend Castiglione. And according to this letter, what is being said, that Raphael always wanted to paint the Virgin in all her perfection, but he lacked the confidence. Day and night he worked on the picture in his mind, but he couldn't perfect it. He always seemed to him that his imagination was working in the dark. Occasionally, the picture fell into his soul like a heavenly beam of light, but he couldn't hold it. It was gone. Then once during the night, his eye was attracted by a bright light on the wall, and when he had looked at it closely, he saw that his picture of the Madonna, incompleted, had been hung there and was illuminated by the gentlest light. And illuminated by the gentlest light, suddenly it was transformed and had become a truly perfect living image. And the divinity in this picture so overpowered him that in his sleep he broke into tears. She looked at him with her eyes in an indescribably touching manner at each moment, as if she seemed to want to move, and indeed sometimes it seemed to him she was moving. And this vision remained firmly stamped within his mind and senses for eternity. And thereafter he was able to paint the Sistine Madonna, just as it had appeared in his soul, etc. And so with this myth now, everybody went to see it. Goethe went to see it. These are figures of the time. Herder went to see it. It inspired Herder wrote a great poem, The Image of Devotion, which is about Raphael, about his image. It begins famously with the words, "Highest love, like highest art, is devotion." And then it tells the tale of an ancient sculptor called Sophronios who tries to make a sculpture of a female divinity and can't do it till he has a vision. And then he ends, "Did the image of the goddess appear to you too, Raphael, in your need, when the holy idea floated before you in the beauty of the earth?" And Goethe, of course, was there, and it's thought that the final scene of Faust is based on his vision of the Sistine Madonna. You remember the last words of Faust? All that is transitory is only metaphor or parable. Earthly inadequacy here is fulfilled. Here the ineffable becomes experience. The eternal feminine draws us on. Thus, for Goethe, there's an urge in the soul towards something at first unknown or dimly surmised, which is in fact the eternal feminine, Sophia, and which finally leads to union with her. And since only like can know like, this urge itself must be of the same nature as that to which it aspires, and must in the end, for union to occur, transform the whole soul into itself, and itself into the whole soul. Following Goethe, then, all the great lights of the German Romanticism went. These included the Schlegel brothers, Novalis, Schelling, Fichte, and Hegel, and they were all transfixed and transformed. Fichte, Steiner's great teacher, a rather austere figure, was particularly struck, and struck above all by the gazes. As I said, this gaze business, when you are seen and seeing. And he wrote, "Yes, it's certainly true, divinely transfigured and encircled by the splendor of heaven, her countenance expresses but a single thought, I am the maiden of the Lord, the infant on her arm who governs the world with his gaze, and the angel whose eyes convey blessedness in their vision. Verily, verily, this is all clearly experienced. There, there, see here, that's what I feel." And so then afterwards, during the century, Schopenhauer writes poems. Fichte, of course, wrote a whole volume of Marian hymnen afterwards. Schopenhauer, Nietzsche, Dostoevsky was the only painting. It hung above his desk. And then right through to Rudolf Steiner. And it still continues, and I want to end with what to me is a very relevant, instructive, and moving example of how and what these Madonnas, and particularly the Sistine Madonna, can bring. It comes in a short essay by the great Russian novelist Vasily Grossman. Now, Grossman was a Jew and an atheist, and during World War II, he worked as a war correspondent for the Red Star, the Soviet Army newspaper, and in that capacity, he witnessed and documented untold horrors, including the liberation of Treblinka, the death camp of Treblinka, of which he's one of the first people to enter, and he was the first person ever to write about it. He wrote about it on the spot. Now, it happened that after the war, the Sistine Madonna was removed from Dresden and taken to Moscow. And it was put into storage there. So from 1945, for 10 years, it remained in storage. And then the Soviets were going to return it to Germany, to Dresden. But before they did, they finally exhibited it in Moscow at the Pushkin Museum. And Grossman went to see it. "What I saw," he wrote, "was a young," this is extract, "young mother holding a child in her arms. How can one convey the grace of a slender apple tree bearing its first pale, heavy apple? The grace of a young bird raising its first fledglings. Oh dear. Yeah, somehow a page dropped out. So, and he goes on then in this vein, but building on it, that the Madonna is all life and hope. and he's just completely converted. And then he leaves the museum, I mean, in this wonderful way. Then he leaves the museum, and confused and troubled, and doesn't, he said he made no attempt to untangle this confusion of thoughts. There was something, something, something. And then as later, quite a week or two later, what rose in his soul was the memory of Treblinka. And he realized that this was she. It was she, treading lightly on her little bare feet, who had walked over the swaying earth of Treblinka. It was she who had walked from the station where the transports were unloaded to the gas chambers. I knew her by her expression on her face, by the look in her eyes. I saw her son and recognized him by the strange, unchildlike look on his face. This was how mothers and children looked. This was how they were in their souls when they saw against the dark green of the pine trees the white walls of the Treblinka gas chambers. Raphael had painted them 4 centuries earlier. This is how someone goes to meet his fate. Grossman goes on to describe many other times and places he's seen the Madonna and her child meeting their fate in the direst circumstances. And yet nevertheless, because she is us, and every human being's fate is our fate too, is what is human. He affirms, the painting, finally, the painting speaks of the joy of being alive on this earth and of the reality that life alone is the miracle of freedom. And so he concludes this essay saying, what can we, people of the epoch of fascism, say before the court of the past and future? Nothing can vindicate us. We will say, there has been no time crueler than ours, yet we did not allow what is human in us to perish. Seeing the Sistine Madonna go on her way, we preserve our faith that life and freedom are one, and that there is nothing higher than what is human in us. In his lecture, preparing for the sixth epoch, speaking of the coming age, which he says anthroposophy is the preparation for, and if we do not have this in view, that sixth age will not be work out so well. He said, among other things about the sixth epoch, a fundamental trait will be that everything we call the fruits of belief today will depend to a far, far higher degree than is the case today upon the single individuality. Will depend to a far higher degree than is the case today upon the single individuality. In every sphere of religion, complete freedom of thought and a longing for freedom of thought will so lay hold of human beings that what a person wants to believe, whatever he or she wishes to hold as a religious conviction, will rest wholly within the power of his or her own individuality. Collective beliefs that exist in so many forms today among various communities will no longer influence those who constitute the civilized portion of humanity. Everyone will feel that complete freedom of thought in the domain of religion is a fundamental right of the human being. In other words, contemplating these Madonnas, we are called to make them our own, each in our own way, as she makes herself known to us. And so with that, I must end. Thank you.